everyone. Welcome to Rhythm Guitar Episode 6. In this lesson, we're going to make a deeper study of time signatures. We've explored time signatures before in the past, but this lesson, we're going to take a look at a little bit more emphasis placed upon the feel for simple and compound time. Now, you know what? If you're not still 100% sure about what exactly the difference is between simple and compound time, let's all just kind of start right there. First of all, simple time, most common, most popular, it's the beat and the feel of music when it's broken down into a two-part feel. And these are the easiest ones to count. They're the most common feels out there because the pulse is coming around so natural to us as musicians. Examples of this are going to be the most common time signature 4-4, and then of course 3-4, 2-4, and we have 3-8 as a part of this, and another one called cut time is shown as 2-2 as a time signature. Now, those are very common, but then we also have the other side of the coin on this, the compound time. Now, this breaks the beat into three-part rhythms, and the top number is always going to be divisible by 3, but not equal to it, of course. Watch out for that. Now, the examples of this kind of compound time feel are going to be 6-8, 9-8, 12-8, and 6-4. Notice all the top numbers are divisible by 3, but there are no time signatures in there with the number 3 at the top. So now that we've clarified that to a greater extent, let's get things started here in part 1 of Rhythm Guitar 6 with some further work and explanation and examples covering both simple and compound time. Example number 1, this is a 4-4 time signature count, common time, probably one of the most basic, and of course one of the most popular forms of simple time feels. You'll see it every place, 4-4 time is a huge aspect of rock music and so forth. So what we're going to start off with here in getting this groove down, because there's a lot of backbeat shots and there's a lot of work here on eighth notes. It's just, tons of eighths and eighth note rests, and a really common sort of rock feel going on here. So what I want to start off with is I want to turn the metronome on, and I'm going to clap through the count on this to give you a good idea how this thing's supposed to function. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and... Okay, so you can rewind the video a little bit, work on that. I think what's really important, though, is working with those example claps that I have. I have those example clap and the example guitar MP3 downloads. If you can work with those a lot, that's what's really going to turn you into a very good rhythm player, because you got to hear this stuff over and over. Me clapping through it a couple times doesn't do the same kind of work as it's going to do for you to listen to the example claps that we have on the MP3. That happen on the website there. So definitely download those MP3s, fire them up, listen to them, work with them. It's going to make a huge difference for you, because we want this stuff perfected so you really can feel it well, so you can clap it and count it. And also the next layer that we want to move to is the scratch strumming. So what I'm going to do for this is, in the scratch strumming, aspect of all this, you want to get to become very familiar with your down and up feel of your right hand strumming. So that feel is super important. You want to get that really smooth. And in this particular groove, we've got a lot of eighth note work, so we really got to get this as perfect as possible. So let me turn the metronome back on. We're at 92 beats per minute. I'm going to go through this with the scratch and strum, which means I'm covering up my strings, and you're just going to hear the scratch effect off the muted strings. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and... So, pay attention to what's happening with my right hand there. I have all the indicators on the handout sheet, so you could tell there, coming into it. 1, 2, 3. So I'm going 1, up, up, down. And then down, up, up. Then up, down. And then up, down, up. And then the last measure, down, up, up, up. So, you know, training the strum hand is a huge aspect of what's going on. You know, have that really smooth motion of the wrist, make it really accurate. And that's going to be so helpful when it comes time round to add the chords in. And hopefully the strum hand is really become quite automatic at that point, and you can put all your concentration and your focus onto what's happening with the chords that you're going to be making with the left hand. So speaking about that fretting hand, let's get into what these chord shapes are for you for coming up here. A lot of power chord ideas. You know, the first power chord, I have it listed as a type 1 C power chord, where we're just giving a, you know, three note, or you could also do it as just two notes. It's up to you. If I do three notes, I'm generally using index, ring, and small finger. If I do just two notes, I'm just using my index and ring finger. I also have a very unique version of a G power chord where it's kind of like the AC/DC version, the Angus Young version, where I'm just playing the low 6th string 3rd fret bass tone. And with the pad of the finger, the pad of the middle finger, I'm killing out the 5th guitar string. And then I just have open 4th and 3rd, and that's giving me my G5th, my G power chord. And then in the handout, you'll also see for the B flat chord, I've got a type 1 and a type 2 coming up later. We'll talk about the type 2s in just a moment. Again, it's another 3-note style power chord, or again, you could just do it as a 2-note power chord. It's up to you. You can follow along on the tab that's in the handout, and you can make your decisions of exactly what your favorite voicings are, or you could follow it note for note and play exactly what's in the handout, you know, which I'd probably recommend, just, you know, sort of tune up your technique even better. But we have three other power chords I want to go over. Starting up at the 7th fret, it's a 2-note barred power chord that's an inversion of our power chord at the 7th frets of 4th and 3rd strings, pardon me. So I've just got these two notes. It's an inversion of a D power chord. Instead of the D to the A, you know, sound, we're getting A going to D, so it's a 4th instead of a 5th, which is an inversion of a power chord. And then when we slide it down, we're going to have the same thing over here on the 5th fret. And that's a C power chord. And then we'll also have the same thing going on at the 3rd fret, which is going to be a B flat power chord. Now, I've labeled the C and the B flat as type 2 power chords because our C and B flat that we did down there, you know, those are a little bit different. Those are, you know, with the root to the 5th and then the octave, if you play it that way, that they're laid out on the chart. So, you know, some unique voicings here. I know it's simple, it's just power chords, but, you know, I think it's really important to start analyzing voicings and coming up with sort of a distinction, you know, about how it all fits together. Now, let's take a look at that chord progression that I have for you. It's a C power chord in the first measure. So, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, and then we move to the G. We have the 8th notes on that G power chord in the next measure, moving to the B flat. And then we have the upbeat of 4 pulling in into the C chord for measure 3. And then on the upbeat of 2 into the downbeat and upbeat of 3, we have a series of 3 power chords of C there in that measure. So then we move down the neck in the last measure, getting the 7th fret to the 5th fret, and then the 5th fret again punching to the 3rd fret, giving me my D to C power chords that are inverted, and then the C moving to the B flat inversion. So in other words, you could also call them, instead of calling them an inverted power chord, you could just call them perfect 4th interval. That's legitimate. So okay, I'm going to turn the metronome on, and I will play that entire riff down for you now so you can hear the whole thing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Okay, so that does it for example number one, our you know, simple time 4/4 count idea. Lots of power chord ideas to work on there, lots of punches. There's a heck of a lot of 8th notes and 8th note rests, and I think this is going to really bust your chops on some good effect for timing, you know, really getting your idea of the beat together and punching all these ideas right in time. It's going to be fantastic for your sense of skill in the world of the beat. Now, I have the goal tempos on this at 92 beats per minute. That might be kind of fast. feel free to drop it. You know, even if you get it at 80 beats per minute, that's pretty good. The goal tempos are there just for something to reach for. If you get it 10 clicks under a lot of these goal tempos, that's still not bad. You know, if you have it really slow, you know, like the, for the goal tempos 92 and you get it only to, you know, 62 or something, you may want to try and push yourself and take it up a little bit faster in the beats per minute department there. But anyway, we're going to take a short break and come back after with example number two, where I've got a 6-8 time feel I want to go through with you. So we'll take a short break and come back with that next. Hi everybody, Andrew Wasson here from creativeguitarstudio.com. I've been a professional guitarist for over 25 years now, and I've been teaching guitar for even longer than that. But today I want to talk to you about your current situation by discussing the study of guitar and the time that you have available to put into it. If you're like most people, you're working a 9-to-5 job and you're working 8 hours a day, 40 hours a week, that's 160 hours a month. How much free time does that leave you left over to study guitar? Let's say you can maybe fit in an hour or so, around 4 or 5 days in a week when you have the free time. And if that is the case, wouldn't you want to make the most of that 1 hour of study, practicing a highly organized, step-by-step, well-structured guitar curriculum? Without a structured plan, it's pretty easy to waste time. You know, a lot of times it happens by just focusing on playing through a bunch of stuff you know, songs you know, riffs you already know, licks that you're familiar with. But practicing stuff you already know will not make you a better guitar player. You need a constant supply of fresh material. You know, if you practice guitar by just playing stuff you already know, before you realize it, time ticks on, time ticks by, and that valuable period of time that you have every day, it gets lost. If left alone, those hours lost every day turn into lost weeks, lost months, and then eventually lost years of wasted time. You'll still be the same guitar player that you were before because you never challenged yourself. I've seen it dozens and dozens of times in my own studio here, but you know, you can change that. In the valuable time that you do have every day, you can start studying a comprehensive guitar course that'll not only educate you, but it'll turn you into a well-skilled musician. So if you want to learn more, sign up for a free account through my website at creativeguitarstudio.com. The general access membership is absolutely free to join. Come in, get your feet wet, and when you're ready, you can go for the paid membership. What you'll discover in there is the most comprehensive guitar curriculum available online. In example two, we have compound time in 6-8. You can tell what a different feel. I mean, this is just so different feeling than what we were just dealing with in the 4-4 time, or what we'll, you know, technically deal with in a lot of the other simple time feels. So moving into compound time, you know, where we've got this, in this case, 6-8 feel, we have to count it differently, think of everything going by differently. And in our case here, as the measures are going around, we're going in the back of our mind, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You can tell the push that we have that's heavier on the 1 and on the 4. And then we're, you know, seeing the feel or understanding the feel moving in that group of 3 and then another group of 3. So we get the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And on the metronome, what's happening there is we're feeling this as 2 dotted quarter notes. So we have, you know, the metronome ticking away here. I have it very slow. I have mine set at 42 beats per minute. It's almost the lowest that the metronome goes. So, you know, as that thing is clicking in the background, though, I got to pace out my 2 groups of 6 on there really clean, you know? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 1, 2, 3, 4. You know, and so if you can start there, get that as your count, and you know, have that really well felt, then you can move on trying to get some of these ideas with the pace that I have as the clap rhythmic groove goes on the page here. So let's get into this now. Really watch those indications of the count underneath the staff. They'll help you a ton in moving along through the proper clapping method. Okay, here we go. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now again, for this example, like we had talked about with the other examples, use your example 2 clap MP3 that you're going to download from the site for this particular lesson plan, because it will help you a ton when you go to try to get these grooves happening for yourself. And if you want to become a good rhythmic player, you know, if you want to have that skill up to a really high level, you're going to have to do this a lot, you know, over and over and over. You're going to have to be jamming on this type of feel to really get it down. So let's take a look at what's happening with our scratch strum effect, which is, again, we're covering the strings and getting used to the down and up motions. I've got all that printed on the handout above on the clap example. But let's move into this, get this happening here. I'll count it in. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So now you can tell what I'm doing probably, I'm sure. You know, you're watching this hand move and you're listening to me count all this, and I'm trying to feel that beat. In fact, you know, when you come into a lot of these exercises, it might even be good to give yourself 2 measures up front to really feel time even better. You know, turn the metronome on, get acquainted with where it's at, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You'll do a much better job in the early days, you know, before you get your act together and really being able to fill this time well and good enough. In the early days of practicing it, you may want to give 2 measures up front to really get in check with the time. Okay, so now I think the only other mention that I want to make is pay a lot of attention to what I've got as examples for the down and up strums. You know, in the example handout, I've got this thing set up as down, down, up, down, up, and then down, down, up, and then down, down. So that's my, you know, setup on it. And even if that doesn't feel great to you initially, try it out. You know, and then you can always alter it and change it later. But, you know, a lot of times if you can work on what feels awkward and get it together in a sense anyway, then it's going to help your overall skill development, because you'll get to the point technically where really you'll be able to do anything. You'll be able to change them up and do any kind of direction with strumming that you would want. And that's really kind of like the overall goal that you want to get to, is having total control and complete mastery over this stuff. Let's move on, though, to the chord voicings. I've got a whole bunch of triad harmony here to run through with you. First of all, showing on the handout the type 1 F major. And this is a F major shape that's going from the 5th string, 8th fret F, into an A at 4th string, a C at the 3rd string, and the middle finger taking that high F octave, doing that shape. Now, if you're familiar with my intermediate guitar program, you'll know that chord as a pattern number 1 F major chord, 5th string root pattern number 1 chord. Then we've got an interesting thing happening with the next shape. It's a C major with E in the bass, so it's the first inversion of C major, and then we move over to pattern 4 A minor chord in the 5th position. Then we're going to move upwards to the 6th position for a B flat major triad. Big bar chord shapes here, all pattern 4 bar chords. If you're familiar again with my intermediate guitar course, these are all given in that program. Then we move down over into the 3rd position for that G minor shape, and then a little bit further down the neck for the F major shape. All of them are the same bar chord major and minors that are covered in my curriculum for intermediate guitar program as pattern number 4 shapes. So again, we got A minor, B flat major, G minor, and then F major. Now this is labeled in your handout as F major type 2, because type 1 that we had in the handout was the one off the 5th string root, and this is obviously different being off the 6th string root. Last chord is E minor, big old open position E minor. So I'm sure that you know that one. If not, work through the handout and get acquainted with it. Now let's move on to jamming on this thing. I'm going to keep the metronome at 42 beats per minute, because that's what's listed as the goal tempo in the handout. And a couple things that you want to be aware of is the shots take place quite quickly, and you want to try and make sure that you got the right amount of value on some of these notes, because in, you know, specifics, let's say look at measure 2, where you've got that A minor coming in, it's It's only a quarter note in the pulse, so we have an eighth note that's a rest in that measure, and we're supposed to go one, two, three, four. You notice that slight pause there, just enough to breathe. One, two, three, four, five, six. Okay, so keep that in mind, and also there's some scratch rhythms on measures one and three, so when we come out of the F chord, moving into that C major with E in the bass, the inversion of the C chord, we need a scratch to sort of, you know, prepare the arrival of it. So we're going one, two, three, and four. So there's that kind of hiccup. And then we got the same thing coming into the A minor in the second measure. So here it is. I'm going to play the first two measures, just alone, isolated, and help you understand the feel better. I'll turn the metronome on too. Here we go. And one, two, three, four, five, six. Okay, so if I count it out, let's count it together. One, two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, and four, five, six. And one, three, four, five, six. Okay, so you know, I think you're getting a much better idea of how to, you know, really count the time, understand 6/8 time, getting used to the compound feel idea. Let's just finish off what's happening in measures three and four here. I've got a G minor chord with the scratch rhythm bringing in an A minor, and then I'm going to move down into an F major that sustains for the first three counts, and then we move into the E minor to wrap things up. All right, let's do the whole thing now. Start. Well, actually, you know what? Let's do the third and fourth measures just to solidify that. Then we'll do the whole thing. Okay, one, two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, four, five, six. All right, so that's the final two measures there, measures three and four. Now let's put everything together. Here we go. One, two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, and four, five, six. Two, three, four, five, six. Two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, four, five, six. I forgot to do the scratch into the second measure. Let me do that again. Here we go. And one, two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, and four, five, six. And one, two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, and four, five, six. One, two, three, four, five, six. All right, that was a good one. Okay, so there you go. That takes care of what's happening now with our compound time feel of 6/8. So now you've gotten a chance here to fully understand a simple time feel in just basic 4/4. And mind you, it's a little bit challenging on that one because that one had quite a few eighth notes and eighth note rests. So that's example number one is a little bit, you know, tough. It's got a lot of power chords that you can move through. But, you know, as we go through this on the website, make sure you always download your PDFs. And my suggestion is to print them out. You know, I do tons of handouts. A lot of people who sign up for my website, they're always saying, you know, I can't believe the value I get out of your site because I can create three-ring binders full of, you know, material and books, and all your courses are on my bookshelf at home, and it's, you know, it's fantastic. It's really what I think is the way to do it. I mean, I know it's great to work on screen and do a lot of stuff on screen on the internet, but I mean, I'm kind of a big believer that you should also have a lot of stuff that you can just pop up on the music stand at home and work on. But anyway, that brings us to the end of part one. And now in part two, what you're going to find is I've got some stuff coming up in cut time. So we're going to look at 2/2 time signature. You're going to like that one. It's got quite an interesting role to it. And then we're also going to take a look at compound time 12/8 time signature. Very popular time signature for blues ballads. And we're going to do sort of an interesting series of dominant seventh chord ideas with some dominant ninths and some straight dominant seventh chords moving around the neck with some different kinds of voicings too. So this material coming up in part two is going to be available on my website at creativeguitarstudio.com in the members area. So if you do not have a membership yet, head over to the website, hit that button that says join now, get yourself your free membership, get in there and at least start studying my Quick Licks program. It's 30 free lessons. It's all the handouts are there. Everything is there. You can watch all the videos and kind of get your feet wet with, you know, the methods that I'm using and, you know, how you like me as a teacher perhaps. And if all the, you know, material looks interesting and you want to take it further, then you can sign up for either the basic monthly package or you could get involved with the annual premium package, which, you know, if you do that one, you save $60 and you get a full membership. Plus you get complete total access to absolutely everything on the website. Go check it out. It's at creativeguitarstudio.com. I think you're going to really enjoy it.
The Creative Guitar Studio Introductory Guitar Program is a comprehensive 10-lesson system with over 90 pages of material designed to take the most basic guitar student up to an intermediate level of playing. It includes all of the most important open position chords, foundational music theory, and music reading exercises. Plus, every lesson has a detailed answer key to help you correctly understand the material as you study at home. From reading music notation to guitar theory to chords and rhythm guitar, the Introductory Guitar Program will give you the foundation that you need to move up to the next level of playing. The Introductory Guitar Program is available for instant download in the View Our Products area at creativeguitarstudio.com.
Head over to my website at creativeguitarstudio.com for the rest of this lesson, where we'll study the groove of cut time feel, and we'll also introduce the blues ballad feel of 12/8. Also, if you have a paid membership, you'll get access to this lesson's handout, the MP3 jam tracks, and a whole lot more. So look forward to seeing you next at creativeguitarstudio.com.